Welcome everybody to our weekly pop-up exhibitions. The rules of engagement are very simple. We have a presenter, either from campus or the community, and objects from the Magnes collection, and we kind of see what happens. We have been also producing a number of these events around the digital humanities, and this is one of them. It's really our pleasure to welcome Mary Elings, Head of Digital Collections at the Bancroft Library, who originally was sort of pinned to discuss her job, her work at Bancroft, but has really decided to work on the Magnes collection in her presentation, and it's wonderful to see that. So, we're, you know, even a double welcome to Mary for joining us. She's been a partner in crime for a number of years in thinking up digital projects of all sorts. So, Mary, the floor is yours. Thank you for joining us.
So I want to thank Francesco for inviting me. In fact, I'm going to be talking not only about Magnes material, but how we do the work we do in Bancroft and how it all relates to digital in one way or another. So first of all, I changed the title a bit. It did previously say preserving digital history as my topic. But I changed that slightly because I want to talk more about how we preserve history with digital techniques, technologies, tools, and how we present that material on different digital platforms. So I'm going to be talking on that more broadly than just about preserving history. So really talking about how we make old material new again by bringing it into the 21st century with digital technologies. So I want to start first by telling you just briefly about what I do at Bancroft. So I'm head of digital collections, as Francesco said. I am responsible for our digital initiatives, which include digitizing our collections. Bancroft is a special collection library. We have large manuscript and pictorial holdings, as well as book collections. I'm also responsible for bringing in our Born Digital program, which is an emerging program that we have just started. Since 2011, so very new. I'm responsible for information systems, where we describe a lot of our archival information, our collections. And then also focusing on digital initiatives that include things like digital humanities support, community engagement, some of the social media, and that sort of thing. And just so you know, I don't do this alone. I would like to have all my staff stand up for a second just to be recognized as the folks who helped me out. Thank you for that. Okay, so as I said, I'm gonna be talking about how we preserve the past by making it new again through the use of digital technologies. And really, history is not digital necessarily, but rather we build digital collections that can be used to preserve history by expanding use, by increasing understanding of historic materials and sharing them with others to keep history very much in the present. And I'm going to talk to you about some of the work we're doing at Bancroft and some of the collections we're building, and look at some of the tools and platforms we're using to preserve history bit by bit. Okay. So, back up one second. There we go. Okay, so first I want to start with a piece from the Magnes collection, and I'm really happy that Francesco let me use this piece. This is the Lilienthal wimple, and it is an object that I actually had the pleasure of seeing in person at one point at Bancroft, and actually found it fascinating and beautiful. It was made by Kochel Heller Segal in Munich, Germany in 1814. But one of the reasons you're not seeing this wimple in this case is because it is too fragile to display very often. And it's been on display a number of times, and so unfortunately it wasn't something we could put out in a case today, which was a great opportunity as a foil for me to discuss how digital will provide us access to something we may or may not be able to see in person. So first, the Lilienthal wimple is important as a document. First, it's a Torah binder that binds the Torah when it's not in use, But a windfall is a Torah binder that was made from a certain sacred cloth. And this particular windfall was made for Menachem Mendel Lilienthal, who later became Max Lilienthal, and he was born in Munich in 1814 and later moved to America. And he was a rabbi and immigrated to New York and then Cincinnati. So this is actually a family document. So it has religious significance, ritual significance, but also it is a tale or a narrative of a young man's life, you know, first and foremost. And so thread by thread, it tells a story of a family. And it was kept in the family for many years before it came here to the Magnes. But we can't see it in person, so I want to show you some of the images that have been created for this object, and they're very high res. And you can see the beautiful embroidery. It's a really rich design. It's called needle painting. And it's shaded satin stitch embroidery on a silk-lined linen cloth. And the first symbol you see is the peacock. And a peacock has many meanings, and the meanings I'm going to tell you are not necessarily for this particular object, but in general, because I am not a scholar in this particular area. Peacocks are, you know, there's some questions. Is it pride that they're representing here? Perhaps purity and or peacocks are a symbol of paradise. So the hare and the eagle are also represented up there, and those could be representations of swiftness and grace. But you can see the beauty of the work, the artistry. We see a lion here, the father's name was Loeb, which is in German lion, so he is represented in the symbol. The text describes the family lineage, the date of birth, it has a prayer and information about the artist. The stag here sometimes serves as a sign of piety or devotion to God, especially when depicted reclining. And then here we get a first glimpse of Max as a child, and in this context he's the youth to be taught. So he's there and ready to be taught. Later we see him as a youth, where he's gaining information and insight from the Torah through Bar Mitzvah. So it's his young adult. And we move on to see the chuppah, the marriage chuppah, where we see Max as an adult who is taking on the responsibilities of wife and family. So we're watching him grow through this object. And then finally, the last symbol is a rooster, which is a symbol of light and protection. And the shield is actually an inscription that tells you who created this object. And it says, made by the hands of Koppel, son of Moses Heller, of the community of Bretzfeld, a resident of the city of Munich. And Heller is actually a term that means light in German. So a rooster awakens at the light. So there's an image there. So I think this image in particular that I zoomed in on, you can see how the quality of the stitching is done. You can see the variety in the coloring. It's really a beautiful piece. And we can see that up close and personal because of the digital images that were taken of this piece. Because obviously we can't see it in person. So I just, you know, in terms of access to this object, we're all enjoying great access and very, very close up view of this material just because we have a nice digital image to work with. So this historically and artistically significant piece, as well as a ritual and religious object, is a really wonderful story of someone's life. And so we are seeing history through an object and through the images that are available to tell us that story. So as institutions, we're always at a point of this conflict between access and preservation. We want to provide people access to materials, but as responsible stewards of materials and curators of materials, we can't always make them available in person. So digital technologies are giving us the tools to make things like this rare and this fragile piece available to the rest of the world. We have to balance the sharing and the preservation of our materials in a way that they won't deteriorate, but that people will have access to them. So one of the ways we do this, you know, this balancing act between this conflict is digitization. It's our third way of providing access to these materials. So at the Bancroft in the early 1990s, we started to explore this third way of digitizing our collections to make them accessible and also to preserve them and to reduce the amount of handling that they were subjected to physically by converting them into digital surrogates. Okay. So, and this is the site on which you'll find most of the materials that we've digitized for Bancroft. At this point, we have about 3 million items digitized. That includes page images, photographs, maps, all sorts of materials. And in fact, the Bancroft is the largest collection in Kalispear at this point. So you can go there to see our materials and the variety of what we have. We have over 2 million visitors annually at the Bancroft. And I'm going to show you roughly how to look at this site. So here is Kalispear. And you can go in and look at the contributing institution. You'll see they're mostly UCs, but there are some other non-UCs in there. The Bancroft is right at the top of the UC Berkeley list. And here you can start to peruse some of our collections. So the first collection we have is the 1906 Earthquake and Fire digital collection. This is a collection of 14,000 images and about 7,000 pages of text about the 1906 Earthquake and Fire, because we have a lot of holdings about this. It's a really rich collection. It has a contextual website, and it's a very highly used set of materials. You can see we have a lot of other interesting collections. We have free speech movement. We have a lot about the Black Panthers, laborers in California, and so on. So there's a lot of really interesting material. We have a lot of World War II posters as well that have been digitized. So all of these materials are nicely available to a researcher online. And this one's slide just seems to keep coming up. There we go. Okay. So 3 million objects, so 3 million. Our collection is, let's see, we have about 70,000 manuscript items alone. We have about 8 million pictorial items. So 3 million is really just a drop in the bucket when it comes to our archival collections being digitized. So we have a lot more to do. And we continue to build digital collections through various grant projects and internal digitization efforts. So one of these right now that we're involved in is the Japanese American Internment Program, and this is through the National Park Service, and we've digitized about 100,000 pages of a unique study that was done at Berkeley where they interviewed internees and had them keep diaries of their experiences. So at the time we digitized these in 2012, much of this material had never been released before. It had been restricted. And when we digitized it, we made it available online, and it came out of restriction. So we went from a completely dark archive of material to a completely light archive. We are now going to continue. We have another 4 years' worth of grant money to continue this, and Charlie and Julie, who are sitting here, are the archivists who are going to be digitizing another 250,000 pages of personal accounts, photographs, as well as more government documents. So, really exciting to have this happening. So we continue to digitize as much as we can when we find money to do so. But this isn't all we're doing in terms of building digital research collections. We're also building digital research collections through our Born Digital program. So where the archive used to bring in cartons and folders full of paper documents, we are now bringing in hard drives, email collections, laptops, social media feeds, and so on, as papers, right? The records of someone's life or of a business are coming in digital form. There is no physical collection. And our digital program is being led by our digital archivist, Kate Casper, who's sitting here with us as well. And it's a really exciting program. We are enlisting very interesting tools as part of this. There's a whole set of tools called digital forensics, and you guys might have heard of, you know, during the Enron thing, they were seizing people's hard drives, and the IRS will go out and seize people's, you know, financial records and things like that. They're using digital forensics. And what makes digital forensics stands out is it ensures the authenticity and integrity of data that is seized, and it can be used as evidence. And so we're using digital forensics because authenticity and integrity of records is incredibly important in an archive. And when you're dealing with digital information, it is the utmost importance. One of the problems we're running into with modern collections, however, is a number of people didn't think about their collections as records. And so we're often getting people's personal stuff work mixed in with their work stuff. As you can imagine, like your email collection, how much is personal, how much is private? Think about what Hillary Clinton just went through. So we have to think, we're trying to think our way through this and how to separate out these personally identifiable and personal subjects away from work subjects and so on. And that is taking us into a sort of new territory in terms of policies and procedures, trying to eliminate private information from going online. So we're often actually having to shut down our digital collections more than we would our physical collections at this point. So, an interesting paradox. But digital tools are really helpful in terms of getting this data. And I wanted to point out, too, a couple of things. So here's a FRED. This is a forensic recovery evidence device. This is what's used by the FBI and the IRS to collect evidence, forensically, digital evidence. Here we have a, what is this, Kate?
It's a 5¼ floppy disk drive.
Oh, we have a better name for it than that, though. Isn't there another name? Oh, okay.
The SC5025.
The SC5025, there you go. That's the name we're looking for. And this is something we had to get off eBay, correct? So we're having to get hardware off eBay in order to deal with some old formats. And then here you see just the beginnings of our collection of materials and the types of materials that we're dealing with. CDs, floppy zip disks, hard drives, laptops, and so on. So what this is allowing us to do, is to contribute to an evolving set of practices in the archival field. The archival field started in the French Revolution, so we're probably about ready for some new stuff to happen. And so we're as a community, archivists are pulling together to look at how we might provide access to this digital material without putting them at risk. So like the WIMPL that we were looking at earlier, the digital technology is helping us to provide access to material that would otherwise be hidden from view, locked on a CD or device like this. So it's kind of an exciting time. And why it's exciting for me, I think, partly is because we're starting to see people actually make use of our materials in new and interesting ways. And the field that I'm going to talk briefly about is digital humanities, where we're using digitized historic materials for research. And it's not just to come and look at one image at a time. We're talking about people who are taking 10,000 documents at a time and then processing them or analyzing them computationally, or a set of images and doing some sort of processing on them and then visualizing the results. I'm just going to show you really an interesting... this is a visualization from Ben Schmidt, who is one of our early digital humanities. This is kind of a canon in the digital humanities field. What happened was that there were a bunch of shipping logs from the early 1700s on into the 20th century. And in shipping logs every day they would note the time, the date, the location, and the weather conditions in this usually handwritten log. People started to digitize and transcribe these logs. And they were using it actually for climate information so that we could look at really how the climate changed in all these years. But what Ben has done is he's taken the exact same data and broke it down by the country of origin, the year, the time, or the month, I guess, and then looking at their locations and plotting them on a map. And this goes on into the 20th century, which is really very cool to start thinking about what kind of questions does this bring up and what kind of questions can it answer. But this data would have otherwise been hidden from view in a logbook. So it's really exciting to think what people can do with the data when it's being extracted from the original in some way, that, you know, such as an email account or a bunch of texts about Japanese internment. We can do a lot of processing on top of these with computational tools that will tell us a lot about those documents that you couldn't do otherwise with digital, without the digital. So digital humanities is not just something, is not something that Bancroft necessarily does. We support digital humanities by providing digital research collections to people who are working in the digital humanities, who need the raw material, the raw text files or image files to do their research. But we are involving community and trying to get people in, to be exploring our collections in different ways, engaging community around our collections. And one of the ways we did this was in 2014 we had a hackathon, which completely scared my director when I first suggested that we have a hackathon because of the negative connotations. But really what this was an interdisciplinary digital humanities hackathon. And what we did is we talked to, reached out to students on campus and said, we'd like you to take our archive, our digital archive of free speech movement materials, which includes images and text about the free speech movement, and come up with a new interface to this material. Because the last interface was built in the 1990s and was terrible. So we had them hack something together in 12 days. And this is the website that our winning group actually put together. It's quite lovely. It has a timeline. You can search by images, text, or audio. It's head and shoulders above what we had before. But it also engaged computer scientists and humanists. We required them to have one humanist on their team. But the computer scientists were the greatest because they said, wow, you guys have all this data? It's like, yes, we do. And it's very cool data. So they were really excited because what we have is data. What we're building when we build digital collections are data sets, research data sets or research collections that are in digital form. So you know, the computer scientists got really excited, and I think really what this did was breathe new life into this historical material. I brought it into the 21st century, which is making, you know, the old new again. So it was really a wonderful project. And our friends with DH at Berkeley and the Digital Humanities Working Group were helpful in putting this all together. So one of the other ways we're doing this kind of engagement is a public platform called HistoryPin. And if any of you were here last week, John Voss, who is the director of content for HistoryPin, was here talking about HistoryPin. And what this is a mapping platform where you can take a historical image and you can plot it onto Google Maps, and then you can put it on Street View and then fade in and out of sort of a then and now. You can see what a place looked like in the past. And you can tell stories about it, and you can create your own narratives on the HistoryPin platform. And it's a really awesome way to engage people with their local communities or an area that's of interest to them with our digital content. And so as part of that, later this month we're going to be holding an event called Visualizing History, Mapping the 1915 San Francisco World's Fair. So 100 years ago in San Francisco in 1915, the Panama Pacific International Exposition was held in San Francisco. Think of Palace of Fine Arts, but think multiple blocks long. So on HistoryPin, we have they have put a fairground map of the World's Fair onto the Google Map interface. And what we're going to do is have an event where people will come, hear about the historical event, the World's Fair, but then they'll pin these thousands of historical images that we have about the PPIE onto the fairground map and start plotting where they were and views and putting them on to this platform. So it's kind of a community engagement opportunity, but it also is going to help us because we don't necessarily know where a lot of these photographs were taken. And so people are going to come together and start plotting them, and I think it's really exciting. So that's happening on November 19th, and the URL, if you're interested in participating, we're happy to have anybody come to this event. It's going to be held in Morrison. It's going to start off with a tour of our exhibit in the Bancroft Gallery, and then a talk by Laura Ackland, who's just written a book about the architecture of the PAN, the PPIE, and then we'll have a pin-a-thon. So it'll be a really fun event. But again, it's something we couldn't have done with the physical collections, and that they, because they've been digitized, we're able to engage in this sort of an event and help people get to know our collections and work with them, and tell narratives that are of interest to them. So, digital is an interesting and complicated thing. So it is not without complications. Digital is, like our analog collections, they have to be preserved and made available for future generations. So digital preservation is a very big deal. And unlike our physical collections, we don't need to limit access. And in fact, it's better that they're accessed more common, or more often. A pretty well-known digital humanist has talked about digital files as needing to be bright keys, you know, that key that's well used and well worn, because by being accessed more often, we can tell when they're, you know, they're active and they're viable, and so the more we use them, the better they are, you know, preserved, because we'll know that they're accessible, viable, unchanged, and reliable. One of our most recent efforts, because of a lot of what's going on campus now, are people working with a lot of digital materials. So someone might download, a digital humanist might download 300 text files and use a place to store them besides their laptop, because we all know laptops get stolen or broken or crash. And so the research IT group and the library have joined forces to create the research data management program, and our lead analyst is over there, Jenny Wartenberg. I told her I'm going to half face, it's almost not a full face. I got your actual chin in there. I thought it was probably your chin. But it's a collaborative effort to look at the management of research data, no matter what the discipline, to develop a series of workshops to inform people about what research data management is, what data is. If we think about, you know, images are data, as I just said, and text is data, maps are data when you're digitized. We will be also putting together a consulting network so that when people have research data questions, they can come to this site and they can be connected at some level with someone who is working in the topic area that they're interested in or needing help with. But the main output of this group is going to be this this guide, the Research Data Management Guide. And this is going to be launching in January in 2016. And this is going to be a key resource for researchers and anybody who is interested in data management. How do I manage all this digital information that I'm creating? So even if you have your own archive of data that's you're not sure how to deal with it, where you can store it, there are going to be very, very Berkeley-focused bits of advice in here, but also it'll help you with general advice about how to save files in current file formats and relevant file formats, non-proprietary open formats, how to describe your data so that you don't lose you know, understanding of your data because of lack of description, and so on. So we'll save researchers the agony of loss through a lot of good advice that'll be on the site. So that when they, you know, their disk drive is corrupted, they'll be able to get to their data because they have it nicely and neatly backed up. Okay, so as we create our own digital collections, we need to manage them responsibly, just like we do with our physical collections. And then we will have the ability to access our data over the long term as we are able to access our physical materials. So we want to continue to do that. All right. So we've come kind of full circle now, coming back to the Lilienthal Wimple, and thinking about digital as digital being a method to preserve analog materials, to understanding that it in itself, like the Wimple, can be fragile, and there's potential risk of deterioration or loss without proper care and management. So unlike physical materials made of silk and linen, digital materials benefit from continued use, and we will continue to keep our digital files as bright keys, well described and well managed. And so thinking about preserving digital history is, again, largely about making the old new again. And we want it to be used, and we want people to transform the analog to the digital as a way of making something new and doing new things with it as we go along. And there's an ancient story that I'm going to close with about Theseus. And this comes from Plutarch. And it's called the Theseus Paradox. And so Theseus had a boat. And the story is about this transformation where the boat, as he goes on his journey, starts to deteriorate. They replace the boards in each boat, in the boat, board by board, until the entire boat is, every board in the entire boat has been replaced. And so the paradox comes in as the question is like, okay, so if the boat has been, every board in the boat has been replaced, is it still the same boat, or is it a new boat? And so that's the paradox. And the question, you know, I see this as a reflection of what we talk about when we talk about digital collections. In one way, a digital item is a surrogate of the original. It's, you know, it's a sometimes imperfect copy. But in another way, it's a whole new thing, right? It's a new file that is at once the past and the present.
So much easier, whether it's word searches or what have you. for humanistic research that it almost begs for an accelerated quantification of research in the humanities. Do you see any evidence that that is likely?
Are you talking about quantitative research methods?
Yes.
Yes, that's already happening. I'm seeing it in my own discipline, which is art history. There used to be much more qualitative type of research, and now we're seeing more on the quantitative side. The analysis of materials using computational tools is just exploding, I think, right now. And we're starting to see a lot of it on campus here. There was just a recent art history in the digital age, and they talk a lot about building data sets and then mapping social networks and looking at changes in data over time and really truly quantifying a lot of that data has been a big part of it. So yes, I think it's expanding both social sciences and humanities quite significantly.
I would conceptualize that as implying that the gap between the humanities and the social sciences epistemologically is going to be narrowing.
Yes. Even the hard sciences in some ways, because some of the methods that they're being implemented by humanists and social scientists are coming out of the hard sciences. So we have the Berkeley Institute for Data Science in the library, and there was a real conscious effort to bring that into the library so that people could actually start to learn from scientists who are using computational methods and various data tools around data science in the hard sciences. And so there's a bit of a blur occurring. So yeah, definitely. Yes?
How good are computers at reading 200-year-old scanned handwritten documents?
Not so good. Yeah, there are efforts afoot. There's a researcher named Schumacher at Groningen University, and he's using artificial intelligence to read the script of the Dead Sea Scrolls. And so they're basically just training the computer to read a hand. And that's fairly common. The accuracy is not so great, but it's becoming better than what we've ever had before. So there's movement to move towards that. Unfortunately, if you get into a collection where you have multiple scribes, it's more difficult.
What about more recent languages, 200 years ago, 500 years ago?
Well, the only good quality optical character recognition is going to be on modern printed texts. But there are, again, efforts to push on that and to make it go to non-Roman texts and so on. So, but the accuracy is not great. If there's consistency and clarity, they'll get a better result. But that doesn't always occur. So they're definitely moving in that direction, but not getting there yet.
A little more mundane. Any suggestions for digitizing photograph collections, preserving that?
Mm-hmm. Well, we're hoping, are we going to have imaging as part of the data, research data management? Specs?
I hope so.
Yes. there are, personal digital archiving is on the Library of Congress is a good source to go, and they will list information about how to do that. But it's about describing them using consistent and unique file names for each of the files, so you don't just say mom 1, mom 2, mom 3. Again, you want to use some sort of nice file name, so you don't end up overwriting files by accident because the names are not unique. And then digitizing at a fairly good quality is always important if you're doing something that you want to keep and share and have multiple uses, because the size of the file will depend on what how big you can blow it up. When you're looking at something, the quality of the file. So yeah, and those guidelines will be on those sites. Yes.
I know very little about computers, but what I wonder is, even showing can we know that in 50 years these things can be aware? I mean,
yeah.
Well, is it, you know, is what?
Yeah.
What is the future?
Just tell me. It's a big problem. Yeah. Well, which is why we're on eBay getting an old reader, because
right.
we can, and most of you know, none of these new computers have floppy disk readers, or as my mother has, SciQuest disks or zip disks, all these, you know, a plethora of different formats that are available. So we try very hard to find readers that can still read certain media, and we pull it off. And what we do is we do a bit by bit capture for most things.
But now we know that's a problem.
Yes.
Going forward, how are you doing?
One of the things we did when we're working with our donors is we have a questionnaire that helps them to kind of delineate what they want to give us and what we want to have out of a collection. You know, like we don't want personally identifiable information and things like that. But it's really, it's you know, organizing your files, separating out a lot of the personal information from, you know, what's relevant to the historical record is, you know, partly the advice we give people when they're preparing materials to be archived. There are format considerations, trying to use very, very common file formats, because as full formats move forward, you know, a WordStar versus a Word file, it's much easier to move a Word file forward because it's a very commonly used. So like very commonly used file formats tend to have a path forward versus some obscure random thing, which a lot of our faculty tend to use these really nifty little tools that they have these random file formats that we don't know what to do with. But usually, you know, if you go towards a pretty common format, you can usually move that forward, or the current version of a software will open an old file. So, yeah, and formats are going to continue to evolve. I think we're moving more towards a cloud environment where we don't have things stored on hard media beyond backups. So there'll be probably less of a problem with just media per se, but certainly the problem's not going to go away. The file format problems will continue to exist, and what we do as archivists is we take those file formats and cover them, we call it normalizing them to a more common or more open standard. Stick to the basics, yes. Keep it simple. Simple's good. Yeah, Jules.
I'm still really concerned and curious about social media and hanging on to social media archives, and especially considering how much Twitter influenced the revolution that swept through the Middle East and North Africa several years ago, and how much it affected it, and how interesting it would be to be able to read those tweets from that time period in 200 years. And so just preserving social media, I mean, some of it's not very interesting, but I think there's a lot, especially when there's something big happening like that, what is being thought about to save all of that?
Well, luckily the Library of Congress is saving Twitter, archiving Twitter, so that's good. But things like Facebook, you know, you could name about 100 different social media sites that may never ever be captured. Our curators work to decide on what social media feeds they want to preserve. So for you know, an artist who has a website, we'll capture their website through web archiving. But a Facebook account is really complicated to download. And in some cases, we'll do that. In some collections, we may or may not collect those. So it really depends on what the curator thinks is a relevant historical document. But the I think the social media sites, at least the big ones, are considering how this has to happen, and that archives and libraries want to preserve these materials going forward. So hopefully they're doing it in some way in mass, like
Library of Congress. Is there any instruction for like how you would go about saving the Facebook page of Masami Karaoka?
Kate knows all. deal with the Facebook accounts and other social media accounts, email accounts, and all sorts of things.
Yeah. It would be great to see the instructions.
Well, actually, it's tied a lot to your personal account. And so as the owner of a social media account, it's really up to you what to do with that. It's very difficult, actually, as artists and librarians, to go and capture someone else's Facebook page because it requires the login information and the password, and that's private information, and we really don't want to be collecting that unless it's really necessary for us. So, but as an individual user, you can go into whatever profile you have on Twitter or on Facebook, and there are instructions there for how you can capture your data. And it's not going to give you an exact replication of your profile or your page, but it will save, you know, your photo albums or your comments or sometimes your connections or your status, and you can choose which pieces of that you can hold on to. You can have that as a record of your account.
Yeah, I mean, this is really becoming an issue for us in terms of faculty who store our data in the cloud through different services like Amazon and so on. It's like, well, when do those become part of the university archives, and how are they transferred? How's custody transferred if the faculty members passed away? So these are big questions that we're really on the verge of just getting into right now. And so there's a lot to be learned yet, bit by bit. Thank you all.
Presenter, you get a copy of the Jewish World. Can't give you the whole world.